Hello, everybody. Welcome to OGT Live, episode 46, here in the second year of doing these lives. And we have a very special show for you tonight. This is a brand that I've been trying to get in the humidor for a while. I was really happy to meet with the gentleman responsible for this brand at TPE and was able to bring it in. So I'm very, very excited. If you guys are joining on tonight, please drop down in the comments what you are smoking and if you're pairing something with it as well. That's also awesome. Of course, sharing those experiences together. Tonight, we are featuring Dunbarton Tobacco and Trust. This is an awesome brand. I want to almost say boutique, but it's not really boutique at this point. Mr. Steve Saka, blender and owner of this brand, has continued to climb the charts. And once you smoke cigars, there's no question of why. So tonight, I am smoking a cigar I had the pleasure of trying for the first time just over 2 years ago. Absolutely fell in love with it. And that is the Mi Querida Triqui Traca. Now, this is a Connecticut Broadleaf cigar. I'm a huge fan of Connecticut Broadleaf. Having this here as an addition here to the shop is awesome. And of course, I'd be remiss without mentioning that tonight we have a killer lineup. Here's our sampler pack for tonight. It is the five pack of the four blends that we are bringing in as Dunbarton. This is the first time we are able to offer this brand. And so we put an awesome sampler together. Far off on the left, you have the Sobremesa Brulee, which is the Connecticut. Fantastic cigar, creamy, sweet, a lot of elegant notes to it, but also a lot of flavor. Excellent, excellent interpretation of a Connecticut cigar. We also next to it have the other Sobremesa, which is almost looks darker in nature, but it's more on that medium side, well-balanced, amazing flavor that comes from there. Then you have the Mi Querida Blue Label, which is a broadleaf, and then Triqui Traca, both in the Toro and the 4x48, the newest size edition. Which I'm a huge fan of those sizes because you have a lot of punch and a lot of flavor behind that. So tonight I'm lighting up the Toro for this. If you guys get a chance to check out the sampler, you can click on the link in this video that will direct you to our website. That's where you can pick it up. Excellent deal on these cigars and a fantastic lineup. So if you get a chance, please jump over, check it out. You will not be disappointed. We got some people jumping on. And so we're going to go ahead and pull the comments as we can. We got Chip in the house saying, so psyched to have the Saka Squatch on with E tonight. Thank you so much, Chip, for joining on. We also have Smoking Sobremesa Brulee by Cigar. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for joining us. We got Nick saying he's smoking an HVC 10th anniversary with a root beer. Well, there's a pairing. I know a lot of people, if you don't want to go with a whiskey or a beer, such soda sometimes can be the go-to. And sometimes you can have some really good pairings with a soda. So we have that together. We have Raider Dave. Raider Dave, how you doing? Good to see you on. Good evening, OGT fam. Smoking an Intergalactic tonight, which is a fantastic cigar. Personal favorite of mine. Excellent Sumatra. We have a little bit left. Not much, but we have a little bit. And Cigar is pairing with a Noah's Mill, which is a really good American whiskey. We also have, let's see, Alan. Hey, how you doing? Smoking an Odd Job paired with water. Well, there you go. I'm just pairing mine with water. Jason's jumping on, having a Cigar Clowns Festivus. That was our feature for the OGT Society into January. And Chip smoking a Dunbarton Tobacco and Trust Todos Los Dias with a Dr. Pepper Cream Soda. There's another soda pairing. So with Saka's blends, the things that I personally enjoy for my palate, I really enjoy the flavor and also the strength, but also the balance that comes with that. Sometimes when you have a cigar that has that strength, but also flavor, it can be somewhat unbalanced. And all you're getting is that like strength behind the stick, not a lot of nuances coming out. However, I love the balance in his blends. It's something that really is, I think, a testament to the talent behind the cigar itself. Let's see here. We got Jeremy Todos Los Dias with a coffee. Excellent. Hopefully it doesn't keep you up late too late up at night. I know my cutoff is around like 4 or so. So if you guys have a chance to pick up the sampler, or if you're unfamiliar with Dunbarton, you can join us here at the shop tomorrow at 6 o'clock. We're going to be doing the official brand release for Dunbarton Tobacco. And we're going to have all those lines available. We're going to be running some awesome deals, do a formal pairing with Redbreast Lustow. And Redbreast, of course, is an Irish whiskey. The Lustow version is where they take that whiskey and they finish it in a sherry cask. So it has some of that sweetness to it. And I believe we'll be pairing it with this Mi Querida. Triqui Traca. So, as I say, thank you so much for joining on. Thank you so much for the love and the support here at OGT. And Mr. Saka will be joining us very shortly. This gentleman is an icon in the industry, not only for his talents in blending, but also packaging, marketing, the whole nine yards. And Dunbarton, I believe I heard of about 4 years ago, and slowly seeing that. And I know that Chip's watching, and he's been a huge proponent as well, giving me the option to try a few more of these, and fell in love with the brand. So really, really special to have Mr. Saka on. So without further ado, if you can all help me welcome Steve Saka here to OGT Live episode 46. Hello, hello.
Hey, how you doing?
Doing good, doing good.
Have you ever watched me do any of these things before?
I have seen about four or five.
All right, because I'm not really a good representative for the brand. So I know you're trying to sell cigars. That this may not help you. So if you want to bail now, this is the moment to punt.
this is the crossroads.
I want to give you the option because that's what I would do.
Well, and I have to say, I had the pleasure of watching the Cigar Authority episode you were on recently. Really enjoyed kind of the delving into what it is like to start a cigar brand, all of that. Really informative. And what I've loved about your lives is the education. And really, tonight is about sharing cigars together and education of tobacco.
All right, let's do it.
So thank you so much for joining on. And for a lot of our customers who are just learning about Dunbarton, if you wouldn't mind just kind of giving a small like snapshot of kind of like where Dunbarton Tobacco and Trust started, how it evolved, and where it is now.
Yeah. Well, it started as me being a cigar geek in the late 80s, early 90s. I then went on to become like one of the first people to write about cigars online. I was probably like the original blogger, but it was long before the term blogger had ever been invented. I ran a website with some friends called Cigar Nexus. It was a total tax sham. We were just doing it so we could write off our cigar expenses with no intention of it ever being anything commercial. And in fact, we did that for about 3 years. And then the accountant said, you know, you guys can't just keep losing money every year. Eventually, you have to bring some money in or you're going to be audited. And we were like, we don't want to do that. So we just decided to close it down. We never had any interest in being in digital media. Then my first actual paying job. You know, and during that whole stretch, I was doing a lot of events and whatnot, but it was all nonprofit just because I was into cigars. My first actual paying gig in the cigar business was I worked as an exec consultant for a company called JR Cigar.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. That was my first gig. And I worked directly for the owner, Lou Rothman. So I spent 4 years working beside Lou. In his company. And for those not familiar with that company, at the time, they were the number one seller of cigars in America.
Wow.
They were collecting money off probably 6 out of every 10 cigars smoked in the U.S.
Wow.
Including those out of retail shops. Owned many brands, had large distribution. Now, that got a little bit upset during the cigar boom, and we've seen other companies come up behind. But at the time they were definitely the 500-pound gorilla. And in the case of Lou loved selling cigars. He loved the cigar business, but he didn't like going to all these shitty third world countries. So that was kind of left to me. I was the person that did all the legwork in Honduras and the Dominican and Nicaragua and, you know, worked with all the house exclusives that we had, which was pretty extensive. I mean, it still is. Altidus bought JR out, and I didn't want to stay at Altidus. I was probably on track to become president of Santa Clara, which is the parent of JR. Santa Clara and JR, they're kind of the same. It's MC management. We don't need to get into that type of minutia. But at the time, the person that was the executive vice president of Altidus, who was the heir apparent to become president of Altidus, I thought was a douchebag. And had we been bought out, but we were bought out. Had he become president of that and I was president of the other, he would have been my direct report and I didn't want to do it.
Yeah.
So I ended up opting to leave. And then I ended up going in, becoming I was named president of a company called Drew Estate, back when Drew Estate was, I don't know, they were doing about $8 million a year, small company. They were really upside down. They were doing like $8 million in sales, and they were $12 million in debt. And wow. I became a vested partner in that with no dollars in, just to come and just do what I'm supposed to do, work. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I was there for 8 years. And when I left, we had become the largest manufacturer of cigars in Nicaragua, and the company was an $80 million a year company. Wow. At the point that I left, and I ended up deciding to leave because my wife hated Miami. I hated Miami, just kind of like I was ready to go, which was kind of foolish because I was actually starting to earn some real money there. But ultimately, my shares got it bought out of Drew Estate, so that was my second cigar buyout. And then I had a non-compete restricted covenant, and when that ended, I started this little small podunky family company called Dunbarton Tobacco and Trust. And I don't know why I did it. I did it because, I mean, even as fat as I am, I'm probably going to live another 20 years. And you got to have something to do, right?
Yeah.
And so that's where we're at.
All right.
And it's it's very simple. I mean, I make cigars that I like to smoke. I just make top quality stuff. I don't care how much it costs. I charge what it costs to make and to make a reasonable profit. And I put it out there, and consumers get to decide whether it's worth the price of admission or not.
Yeah.
If I don't like it, if I don't buy it, then I don't make it. You know, it's just that simple. And it's kind of where it is. But I mean, I've had a good, I've had 30 years doing this, and I, you know, and everything from the farming to the pre-industry operations. I was the person that was the direct in charge of the Drew Estate factory, had approximately 1,700 employees there. I pretty much have done most everything at that end of the spectrum.
Okay.
And then, you know, I was lucky to also be at the other end, the marketing and the sales strategy and the business administration and the operating of a company. And it's been quite an educational experience, to be honest with you.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and working in so many different aspects of the industry, I think what's more common to see, it seems like, is that someone either starts as a consumer and then they want to do their own brand, or they've worked as a blender or as a marketer, and you've done it all.
I think it's really typical. I think the place that I have the greatest hole, if you want to look at it, is on the sales side.
Okay.
I've never been in a sales capacity. I mean, selling to consumers, telling the story, representing the product, explaining the brands. I mean, you're always essentially selling, right? I mean, it's just kind of part of what you're doing. If you're representing, you're selling to a degree, but actually to be part of sales per se, that's never been something that I've ever been. So that's probably my greatest weakness, but honestly, it's never done anything. It's never hurt me in any way, because the reality is, if you make stuff that people want, you really don't have to sell it that hard.
Yeah.
You know, it's just that simple. And I mean, that's probably my, that's the area in the industry that I'm definitely the weakest, is on the sales aspect. Dealing with the retailers, dealing with the distributors, dealing with, and it's not that I haven't, but I don't think I'm particularly good at it, to be honest.
Gotcha. Now, I know that when we went to TPE and we were able to sit down at the booth, we got the pleasure of talking to Cindy Moore. Does she handle a lot more of like the sales side or the administrator side?
Cindy is my wife, for those that don't know. In the family company, she's a 50% partner. She runs the office side of things.
Okay.
All the U.S. operations, the warehouse, the office, the administration. All of that team, the people that you will interact with, Eric, you know, that's all handled by, that's under Cindy's domain.
Okay.
And David Lafferty's domain. He's the VP of sales.
Okay.
I don't really get too much involved in what they're doing. The only thing that's critical to me when it comes to the actual sales number is that they're bringing in more money than I'm spending, because I'm always spending a shit ton of money. And no, you're laughing. I wish it could be laughed off, but I mean, it is crazy how much I spend. So that's the only part of the sales part that I concern myself with.
Okay.
Is, are they keeping ahead of the money I need to keep doing what I'm doing, planting test crops, investing in new tobaccos, starting a new production line, purchasing the materials that I need, whether it be actual leaf or whether it be just simply, I mean, just 2 weeks ago, I put in a band order for the first half of the year, and it's six figures for little 3-inch strips of paper. It's
a
six-figure order, and that's for nothingness, right? So spending, I'm burning through a lot of cash, but I kind of know that, it's not not something I don't expect.
Now we have a question from Chip, and it's actually a good time to invite everyone else. If you have a question for Steve, myself, drop it down in the comments. I will pull it as best as I can to get those comments up and questions. And actually, this is a question I had as well. Chip is wondering where does the name Dunbarton come from when you started the company?
Yeah, Dunbarton. It's very lazy. It's the town that I live in New Hampshire.
Okay.
It stems from a Scottish town called Dumbarton with an M in it.
Okay.
The original settlers came from there. They named this place Dumbarton too, but then they quickly realized that the word dumb is not a good word to have in an American city's name. So they very astutely changed it to Dun with D-U-N. And this is kind of where you get into names are relevant. And I wanted the company to be a name that it feels like it has some gravitas, some weight, but it's relatively simple. And the other thing I didn't want to do is I didn't want to put my own name in the brand, because that kind of because the reality is most cigar consumers will never know who Steve Saka is, and they'll never give a fuck who Steve Saka is. And once you just embrace that fact, it makes things much better for you. So it was just going to be Dunbarton Tobacco.
Okay.
And then in the beginning, I was looking to purchase an old bank building in the Concord area to locate the company in. Mm-hmm. I really thought I was going to buy it.
Okay.
But it turned out that I could never come to me and the owner could never come to an agreeable price on it. But it was too late. I had already done the incorporation. And that's mm-hmm. where the trust got tacked in, because I thought we were going to be operating out of that old bank facility. We didn't. So it's a bit of a mouthful. I can tell you Dunbarton Tobacco and Trust doesn't fit very well on a t-shirt, doesn't fit very well on a hat. It's not the best. And I know for a lot of people, they just call my cigars by my name. I know a lot of retailers do that.
Yeah, Saka cigars.
I don't know. Look, I love my last name. It's a great name, Saka, simple, clean, mm-hmm. a lot of Sakas, at least in America. But it doesn't have a good flow when it comes out of your mouth. It's more like something that you like hack up, Saka. So I never really could imagine it as a brand name.
Okay.
From my perspective.
Gotcha.
And while we're on this topic, I want your viewers to know the quality of this will be entirely dependent on the questions they ask, because I don't have any sort of set thing to say. Mm-hmm. And I can pretty much lie or make something up about everything. So the more interesting the questions are, the better it will ultimately be for everybody. And the other thing is, for me, there's really nothing off limits. I'm willing to talk about pretty much everything.
Well, and which was pretty indicative, like I say, about that Cigar Authority episode, and it was really enlightening to me, just kind of like the behind the scenes, what kind of goes into that, and also the progression of a company. Something that really stuck out to me when you were talking about it is that, especially for when companies do a startup, there's a lot of almost like stretching of the truth or lying to say how well a company is doing this way or that, which was really enlightening to me for certain.
Yeah, but I don't know why people wouldn't think that, because it's just human nature. It's that basic fake it till you make it kind of premise that almost everybody lives under. And the other thing too is, I mean, you have to understand that 98% of the interaction that you as retailers and most consumers have is dealing with the sales face of the company. What I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
So there's salesmen being salesmen doing what salesmen do.
Right.
Okay. And therein lies. I mean, I mean, most of the people that you interact with, and even this is true with brand owners, they don't really have any comprehension of how the product is actually made. They just simply know more than you know, which therefore ends up making them appear to be an expert to you.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah, definitely.
You know, like, some guy starts talking to me how to be a bricklayer. Yeah, I kind of know how you lay bricks. I've seen it done before, but I've never actually done it myself in a serious capacity. Yeah, mm-hmm. I pumped the bricks in the wheelbarrow because my dad told me to move them, but I don't actually know what it is to be a bricklayer. So if there's a guy that's knows something about laying bricks and he starts talking to me about how to plumb it and straight line and how to mix the mortar and this, guess what? To me, that guy's an expert bricklayer as far as
right.
I'm concerned.
Right.
He just
right.
simply knows more than I do. And that's kind of what ends up happening. So most of the interactions that consumers get, they're a little thin and they're a little shallow.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
That totally makes sense. Yeah.
And it's just kind of the way it is. The thing is, you don't know that it's thin and shallow because you don't even know what to ask.
Right. Right. And the yeah, other thing there's is, no point guys, of reference.
Yeah. And look, these guys, look, I don't fault them. I mean, they're dealing the cards that they've been dealt to work with. But mm-hmm. I mean, if you're visiting store to store and you're representing a brand and you're, you know, doing three events a week and you're getting yelled at by retailers and yelled at by your home office and filing sales reports and trip logs and compiling your receipts, you don't know anything about curing tobacco. You don't know anything about harvesting tobacco. You don't know anything about real sorting or pre-industry or fermentation right. temperatures or bacterial additives or any of those things. That's something that's just not in your lexicon.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah. So.
No, definitely. Definitely. So we got two questions here. And I'm going to pull this one from Nick real quick. He's wondering what got you into cigars? Like what was the main pull in the beginning?
So I enlisted in the Navy when I was 17. My mom signed the papers to get rid of me. And I went in when I was 17. And my first ship, which happened to be my only ship because I didn't end up re-enlisting, I was stationed on a Knox class frigate, the USS Canole. And my first battle station or GQ station on the ship was on the 50 cal gun. And I didn't get the exciting part of firing because I wasn't a gunner's mate. I was an electronics technician, right? Okay. The gunner got to fire the gun, got to play with it, but not actually, you know, in the real situation. But the senior chief at that station was a cigar smoker. Okay. And because you were outside and you'd be at GQ sometimes for hours and hours just doing training exercises, he would smoke cigars. And it was just kind of like mandatory that you smoke okay. cigars with him. And he smoked really, really bad cigars. But I didn't know it at the time, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And but I went through it. I kind of liked it, but I wish they hadn't tasted so bad. But I didn't know. You know what I mean? I had no standard.
Right, right.
And I had an operations officer named Walter Laird. And Walter was a cigar smoker. And he just took pity on me and said, you know, Saka, that crap that senior's giving you, those aren't real cigars. Come to my stateroom. Let me give you some cigars. So, Lieutenant Laird, he was a lieutenant at that time. Because remember, it was a Knox class frigate. So small boat. He gave me, I don't know, four or five. I don't remember what they were, but they were kind of like the stock legacy brands. Monty okay. and Romeo and H.M., which at the time were the top of what was available in the marketplace. Yeah. And yeah. some could argue they still are. I'm not going to get into that quandary. But it really kind of set me down the path. You know, it's kind of like once you try something decent and good, it makes you just want to have more decent and good. And
right, right.
So I pretty much started cigar smoking, I guess when I was right around 20. 19? Okay. Yeah, almost 20. Is about when I start, not counting the Swisher Sweet down by the river with the
right.
six pack of Lone Star, you know, while I was a kid with three of my buddies. But I mean, first right. real cigars were in the Navy back okay. when I was about 20 years old.
Okay. Well, and on the topic of like smoking cigars and kind of expanding the palate and such, Cigar says, I have a question. Asked Pete, Nick, and heard back from them. I'm curious about your thoughts. Steve, smoking 10 cigars a day or more, how do you keep your palate fresh to test blends and make adjustments when needed?
I think it's like everything. I think that I seem to be less impacted by a dirty palate than most people. And I don't know why that particularly is, but I don't tend to get this kind of wash that most people do. Now, I'm not saying that when I get to the end of the day and I'm on, and the reason why I said 10 is because that's pretty much what I smoke every day.
Okay.
I smoke about 10 cigars a day for pretty much the last, I don't know, 25 years.
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, wow. I added up once. I've smoked over 100,000 handmade cigars since I started smoking. I'm probably close to about 115, but I say 100 just to play it safe.
Yeah.
I don't know why. I mean, I rarely get total palate fatigue.
Okay.
Now, are there some things? Yes. If it's something I really got to focus on, I try to make it earlier in the day.
Okay.
I try to drink, if I'm really testing and really paying attention, I will drink sparkling water, mineral water at room temperature. An unflavored Topo Chico or a Pellegrino or something like that. I might have some sort of water cracker, unsalted, very plain, okay, simple biscuit. The other thing that I will do is, a big part of sensing tobacco is your olfactory, your sense of smell. It's such a key component to what you do. So I will use roasted coffee beans.
Okay.
And I will deeply inhale them, because what it does is it doesn't cleanse your olfactory. Okay. It's not like a sorbet.
Right.
But what it does do is it gives you such a distinctly different aroma
that
it resets it in a way so that you can better detect the next aroma change.
Okay. Okay.
And then the other thing too is, I don't know, is a clean palate necessary? I mean, does anyone ever smoke cigars with a scientifically clean palate?
Right.
I mean, you see here, I saw, Dr. Pepper cream soda. I saw Noah's Mill. I saw this. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, people aren't smoking it like they're in a laboratory either.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And look, there are some things that are very simplistic that for me make a big difference. Like one of the key things that I always look at whenever I'm testing anything, whether it be something I'm working on or another cigar, I just ask myself a basic question. Does it make me drool? If it doesn't make my palate moist as I'm smoking it, it's no good. It's just that simple.
Interesting. Okay.
If I like to put it in my mouth, it makes me salivate. So anytime anything dries me out, instantly, no good. Something's not right. Just a real simple gut check that you can always instantly do with anything. Rather than saying, oh, let me see if there's pencil lead and whatever, and yada, 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 boom, 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 and discern these flavors and try to talk myself into liking it. Just simply, does it make you salivate? Because stuff that you like in your mouth makes you salivate. It's just a physiological reaction, And the other thing, too, is I'm really very cognizant of the mechanics of a cigar. I think that's something that a lot of people overlook. Cigar has to draw well. It has to burn well. And not just for the obvious reasons, but because it has a dramatic impact on the flavor and the aroma when a cigar isn't properly combusting.
Yeah.
So, for me is a very key critical thing. Like, I can tell when someone's smoking one of my cigars and it's tight just by watching the smoke. Because a good cigar for me, I want to take a really big pull out of it.
Yeah.
And what I want to see is I want to see the smoke continue to travel out of the head
on
for about 4 to 5 seconds. And if it doesn't continue to cascade on its own for 4 to 5 seconds, that cigar is just simply too tight.
Okay.
So
yeah.
Very easy thing to do. Another thing that's really important to me is that I choose the materials that not necessarily because always they're the best flavor or the best aroma, because if the cigar doesn't burn evenly, you're never going to get the ingredients in the proportions that I intend you to get. The recipe,
when it
starts to cone, you're getting far more of the base and the outer materials in the tripa, because the Lajero isn't burning as quick. When it tunnels, way too much Lajero. When it burns, canoes really uneven. It's changing the blend. So I don't need the burn to be Instagram perfect picture, but I do need it to be relatively straight for the entire duration of the cigar. And a lot of times that has to do with you figuring out what materials play well with each other. Because you can't just pluck two things that taste good and smell great and put them together and it ends up being tasting and smelling great. Because if they don't play well with each other, the one doesn't, you know, the slower material doesn't help the faster material slow down. The faster material doesn't help the slower material keep up. You know, that's really relevant to the experience. So another thing for me is I like cigars that stay lit. I have this thing I call the piss test. I always smoke. So like if I'm in my truck, I can't drive my truck without smoking a cigar. I mean, even if I'm just going 10 minutes, I'm lighting a cigar. It's just the way it works. So whenever I pull into a gas station, I have a lit cigar. I put it down on the bumper. I start the pump. I get the gas going. I go in. I take a piss. I go buy some beef jerky, maybe some sunflower seeds. I pay for it. I come out. I put the pump back in, yada, yada, yada. And I go to the back bumper. I expect my cigar to still be burning.
Okay.
I expect to not have to relight it. And look, that's not true if it's a 42 ring gauge cigar.
Right.
That's not true if it's a 64 ring gauge cigar. But anything that's pretty much from 46 to 54, it should be able to retain its temperature to continue combusting. I don't like cigars that you have to continually relight.
So I
find that to be a flaw.
What would you say is like a component to kind of make that along? So if you're constructing a cigar, what is it a ratio, like how you're saying Lajeros and tobaccos that combust?
Not necessarily,
well,
because see, even those terms are relative. So Pilato Cubano Lajero, okay, which is essentially is just the texture grade of the Lajero. It's the thickest of the Pilato Cubano. It's not even a low viso compared to a sun-grown Nicaraguan Criollo. So all Lajeros aren't created equal. All Secos aren't the same.
Okay. Yeah.
It's only relative to the individual variety of tobacco in the individual place in which you grow it. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because so it isn't even just as simple as that. And sometimes it's not even just the texture, it's also the grain. It's the way the vein structure lays on the leaf. I mean, certain leaves have a tendency to burn a little swirly. Other ones have a tendency to run a bit. Some have a tendency to shoot up the exterior lateral lines on the thing. And you have to understand how that tobacco works so that you can make sure that you don't, hey, I don't want to have two things that tend to burn along the lateral lines side by side in this blend, because what's going to end up happening is that's going to create a problem. Now, look, it may work fine 6 out of 10 times, 7 out of 10 times, but what happens when it doesn't work?
Right.
You end up with what? 20% of cigars don't smoke right. 30% of cigars don't smoke right. I mean, that's just not acceptable. Now, on the flip side of that, no matter how much attention to detail and no matter how much care and no matter how much money you spend, you're never going to get handmade cigars to be perfect.
Mm-hmm.
The one thing that is consistent about all handmade cigars is their inconsistency. So there's a certain amount of air factor that you as a consumer and me as a maker have to accept. And I think consumers would be kind of surprised. The average factory, they kind of consider an 8 to 9% failure rate normal. A high quality production, 4 to 5%. When you get over 2%, you're really in rarefied air when you get above the 2% number.
Yeah.
And obviously that's what I always strive for, is to be better than that.
And then you have the struggle of, I mean, once it's sold to the consumer or to the retail shop, it's out of your hands. And then they've got their own humidification system. Yeah, but
the way it works is I get blamed for everything. So, you're right. There's a lot of things that are beyond my control.
Right.
But ultimately what? You're going to have that fight. You're going to argue that, it's just a point where there's no win to it. I think that an experienced cigar smoker bakes it into the cake that not all cigars are going to be perfect.
Right.
And what ultimately ends up happening is they find a brand they really like, and they're willing to deal with the occasional subpar cigar in the mix.
Mm-hmm.
The question is it the rare occurrence? Is it the occasional, or is it a regular occurrence? What I would say to a consumer when it's a regular occurrence is find a new brand.
Yeah.
Because that's not good. The other thing I would say to a consumer is when they, and look, it happens. And the sad part about it for consumers is it tends to run in lots. So when things go awry, you could get an entire box. So you can produce 10,000 cigars and they can all be fine. But then you literally get a day where 12 boxes in a row, they're all bad. Okay. And
50%
of cigars in the boxes are terrible. And that's terrible for the consumer because he just got unlucky is what happened to him. Mm-hmm. And then it's a question of how do you respond as a company? It's one of the reasons why we warranty everything and we kind of do it. No questions asked. We sometimes have some questions. We're curious. Sometimes we'll ask for the cigars to be shipped back. You know, because I want to inspect them. Mm-hmm. But we pretty much accept at face value. It's baked into the price to do that. At the same time, we don't expect consumers to abuse us.
Right.
Consumers abuse us. After the third time, we kind of say, you know what, Joe? Like, don't buy any more fucking cigars because they don't work for you.
Right.
you kind of part your ways. But that very rarely ends up happening.
Okay.
Most people that are buying our products are in a price point that they're not there to get over on you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's not like you're buying Dunbarton Tobacco and Trust and you spent $39.95 for 10 cigars. You know what I mean?
Right.
It's a different consumer.
Yes.
And that consumer, he's like, yeah, the cigar's bad. He throws it in the ashtray. He lights it over. Thank God this one's good. Mm-hmm. And he goes on his merry way. But at the same time, if a consumer gets something and he's really having a bad experience, I want to hear about it. I want to try to make it right for them.
Right.
You know what I mean? But but you're right. There are things that are beyond my control. It's just the way it is.
Yeah. Yeah, no, definitely. Chip is wondering, he's saying, love all the blends. My favorite is the Total Celestias, but I feel like it's overlooked by people because of the other bigger, of your other big blends. Your thoughts? What's your thoughts on?
Yeah, I can tell you, Total Celestias, I ceased production on it last year. There won't be any Total Celestias probably all of 2022. And when I ceased production, it was a combination of two reasons. The problem is, as we grow, I have another brand, Mi Querida, that uses one of the same tobaccos in it. And Mi Querida is selling way more than Total Celestias. Yeah. The growth on Total Celestias was running only about 17% a year, where the growth on Mi Querida is running close to double every year over year.
Yeah.
So I had a limited amount of tobacco that I had to decide to allocate. I decided to allocate it to Mi Querida and put Todos on hiatus. But I didn't close it out or shut it down. We canceled about 2,000 boxes worth of back orders to stop selling it. What is it going to do? I was going to have to change the blend and that doesn't work.
Yeah.
I think the reason why Todos Las Dias is definitely, if I have a failure, that's the failure. And that's still with it getting consensus number three of the year and it growing every year and even growing last year 17%. It didn't grow the way the other ones did.
Okay.
Part of the problems, there were two major problems. Well, three problems. First problem is the name isn't very good. That's my fault. It's a little generic. The second problem was the original packaging wasn't very good. Also my fault. In my defense on that one, though, that was the product that got released during that crunch for the FDA.
They
announced the rules in May, and everything had to be in the marketplace by August 8th. Uh-huh. So I couldn't just focus on Todos, which was supposed to be released that year. I had to focus on like 12 other things to make sure I met the August 8th deadline.
Right.
So it was just in a mad scramble. And then the blend is rather difficult, I think, for most consumers because it's a really strong cigar. It has a lot of nicotine, but it's also very smooth.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like if you really like strong cigars, most people like super strong cigars. They like to get that little bit of punch in the mouth. They like to get that bite. They like to get that kick. And what Todos does is it starts off as pretty much a medium, kind of smooth, easygoing cigar. And what ends up happening is the longer you smoke it, the more that pepper intensifies.
Yeah. So
it has the pepper, but it's more like when you eat a curry, okay, or a mole, where it just slowly builds and builds and builds and builds. So it's kind of a peculiar blend in a way that, is it for the guy that wants smoother and milder? Or is it for the guy that wants really strong and bitey? Because it's actually both, but it doesn't serve the needs of either of the two.
Interesting.
It's a really peculiar, odd blend. I happen to love it, but like I said, it's my slowest grower, only up 17 points last year. So the market doesn't love it as much as the others. And then I also have to make a simple commercial decision.
Yeah.
Eric, you only are going to give me so much space in your store. You're only going to buy so much from me. Now, hopefully the brand does well for you and you will add more. Mm-hmm. But do I really want you to put what I know to be the one that sells the slowest and is growing the slowest? Do I want you to use space on your shelf to do that? You know what I mean?
Yeah, no, definitely.
So I also have to kind of protect you from you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's my job to not let you make a bad choice.
Right.
Because if you make a bad choice, well, then in the end, that hurts me. And if I knew that, hey, if he chose Todos Los Dias, which I love, over Triqui Traca, which I love, I know that's a mistake. Because I know if he puts Triqui Traca in the shelf by just the numbers, Triqui Traca is going to do much, much better for him.
Yeah.
Now, I would say there's an exception to this. Todos Los Dias, for some of our stores, they're rather upset because it was their number one selling Dunbarton cigar in the store.
Wow.
But the reason why is because the owner loved it. The staff loved it. The lounge that hanged out in the store loved it. So they championed it, right?
Mm-hmm.
But left to its own devices with no extra love, Todos does not do as well as any of the others.
Okay. And sometimes it really, unfortunately, how you're saying is sometimes you got to make that commercial decision. It's also, you got to kill your darling sometimes. To kind of,
I put it on hiatus. I think what'll end up happening, because like the thick Lonsdale is genuinely one of my favorite cigars that I make.
Okay,
it's other Todos Los Dias. So probably what'll happen is sometimes towards the tail end of the year, I'll probably do a small production of it, 1,000 boxes or something like that.
Yeah,
and then make it available to those TLD accounts that want that one.
Right.
And hopefully by the time we get to 2023, my tobacco, constriction will alleviate a little bit.
Okay.
But I don't know, because it's really going to depend on what happens with Triqui Traca. If Triqui Traca continues to scream, it's going to just continue to eat the material.
Yeah. Now, sorry, we got a lot of questions here. Just trying to pull one here. It says, this is Cigar saying, I have another question. The unicorns that don't make the cut get destroyed. Is there no way to repurpose the tobacco considering the cost?
Well, I mean, all tobacco on anything that gets destroyed does get repurposed. It just ends up being going into whatever the sandwich blend is that they make in the factory.
Okay.
I don't make any sandwiches at Hoya, so it doesn't help me there. The thing with the unicorns is in the beginning, we used to have to make about the first year we did it, we made about 2,400 to finally have 1,000 of them pass. So we ended up having 1,400 bad cigars.
Wow.
And every year as we've done them, we've gotten much, much better.
Okay.
So about 2 years ago, they had done a production of only 1,600 of them. And out of the 1,600, 1,400 of them were good. But I have this 1,000 unit limit that I live by. So, but I couldn't bring myself to destroy 400 perfect ones. So what I ended up doing is I ended up having tuck cut just an inch off the foot. And I called it a horn of a dead unicorn. And I didn't sell it. I would use it for special unicorn events to give away.
Okay.
Last year's production, we got to the point where we're getting so much better at it now, 4 years in, that there was really very little to even turn into horns at all. There were no horns. So today we aren't destroying as many as we were in the beginning. In fact, I think we destroyed maybe out of the production, maybe 100 cigars, 112, 114. So I now have it, instead of having an attrition rate of 140%, I now have a attrition rate of 14%. You know what I mean?
Right.
So, it's definitely improved over time.
Well, and I mean, just looking at it from like a logistics standpoint, because I know it's a high cost on just production. I mean, it's got to be. Is it more of a passion project for you?
Project. Unicorns are dumb. There's no. They're grossly expensive. They are definitely not worth the money. They do not taste anywhere 10 to 5 times better than any other cigar I make. It's just that's what the cost to make them because of what we do.
Is, yeah,
it makes it a unicorn, but it makes no practical sense whatsoever. They're actually a little bit of a. So like right now, I think we have back orders on 7,000 unicorns, right? So I basically have the next 7 years of unicorns already committed. But that isn't the way it works. The way it works is when we get a new select purveyor and they want some unicorns, we just steal from Jeff at Corona Cigar or from Abe and or from somebody else that wants, you know, 21 of them or 40 of them, and they don't get 40. They end up getting 17 that year or 14 that year.
Okay.
The problem for me with unicorns is the shape in itself is not a difficult shape. The problem with the unicorn is it's a difficult shape with those heavy materials. That really dramatic, sharp taper is really a very difficult task of the bench to achieve with those materials. So for me, unicorns, 1 out of 100, 1 out of every 200, it won't smoke right. And that's a real problem for me, and there's no way I can rectify it. It's just simply the way it is. And the problem for me with unicorns are, and I always tell consumers when they buy a unicorn, they should smoke it, and then they should contact me and tell me it didn't burn right, because I'll give them a free unicorn because I feel guilty about it. So they cut their costs in half right from jump. The problem for me, though, is it ruins somebody's special moment, because people buy unicorns not as cigars. You don't spend $100 on a cigar because it's
right.
You buy a unicorn because you want to mark a special moment. You want to celebrate the birth of a child. Mm-hmm. You want to buy a pair of them to smoke with your dad on his 75th birthday. I mean, people buy them to smoke with their Afghan war buddies that they haven't seen in 20 years. If you look at the way unicorns are consumed, most of them are consumed to mark a special moment or a special occasion.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's how a unicorn is typically used. It's not to light it up on a Tuesday because, hey, I want to just have a good cigar. Because you can have a lot of other cigars that are good. You don't have to spend that kind of crazy money. And the problem is, when it doesn't perform, I ruin that moment for that person.
Interesting.
Right?
Okay, yeah. I can
give them that moment back.
Right.
Contact me. I'll replace the cigar.
Right.
But I can't give you that experience that you're going to have with your dad on his 75th birthday.
Right.
Really special cigar that you bought a year ago. And have been saving for this moment. And that for me is one of the things that I so hate about the unicorn.
Okay.
And the reality is you don't make much money. So like last year, I produced about 1.5 million cigars. Does 1,000 unicorns matter? You know what I mean?
Right.
I mean, even at the crazy price, I mean, the reality is unicorns cost me about $37 to $38 each to make. We sell them at a gross margin of $50. So, well, for $50 is the gross price, wholesale price.
Yeah.
So that means I'm making, let's say, $13 per unicorn. So all 1,000 unicorns equals $13,000. Net profit of the company is about 5%. So what does that mean? It means every unicorn that's sold for the entire year basically brings to the bottom line about $800-$900. That's what unicorns are worth to me. They're worth $800 or $900 a year. But yet there's this huge risk factor involved.
Yeah.
In them.
Yeah.
So I keep saying I'm going to stop doing them. But at the same time, I do see so many people mark so many special moments with them.
Yeah. Yeah.
That I don't know. It's a tough one.
Right.
So I have no desire. And the truth is I have to grow unicorns because I just have so many people that want them. So I've now decided where I was going to do just 1,000 a year. I'm now saying that for the first 1,000,000 cigars, we'll do 1,000. And then for 1 million to 2 million, we'll do another 1,000. And 2 million to 3 million, we'll do another 1,000.
Yeah.
The only exception to this rule, and part of the reason, the other reason I want to grow is because in a unicorn, I physically touch every leaf. I personally hand sort every piece of tobacco that goes into your unicorn.
Wow. Yeah.
I'm the one that does all of it. And it's very time consuming for me to do that. I'm busy. The other thing I would say about unicorns is, if I ever start seeing them like in the secondary market being flipped like really aggressively, like I've seen some other things in the past that are like super uber limited, I will flood the market with them. I will totally ruin it for people. So if you think you're going to buy a unicorn and sell it for $400, trust me, that might happen for the first few people that can get away with it, but
I'll
make fucking 40,000 of those goddamn things if that's what it takes.
I won't have
tobacco anymore, but I'll flood the market because
that
whole flipper mentality, I've always hated it.
Oh yeah, for sure.
You know, look, it's a free market. God bless you. You can do what you want. You can buy what you want. You can sell what you want. You paid your money, but I don't have to do something that encourages the flipper.
Yeah, market, exactly. Right?
I don't have to set up a scenario. I don't need to be Rolex that basically makes $9,000 submariners that really should be $7,000 that they make so few of, and the way they distribute them, they're instantly 15 to 17,000 new in the box. I mean, that's a totally artificial market.
Right.
Good watch, good company, but that's just a sham. All that's going on there. And it was the same thing when I was at Drew Estate. You know, we'd spent 3 years to make feral flying pigs. We made about $1.85 on every feral flying pig. Some jackass would be lucky, show up in the shop the day that guy's four boxes got delivered. He'd buy them all. And next thing you know, he was selling them for $100 a piece. So here's some guy that just got lucky in the shop and has room on his credit card.
Right.
He's now going to literally make, $85 a cigar. When we did all the work and we made $1.85 on each cigar.
And now there's the expectation of whoever bought that cigar at $100 being like, this is $100 cigar.
Right.
So it's going to smoke like $100 cigar. When originally that company $100 didn't have that.
Smoke like, I mean,
yeah.
I mean, once you get beyond, look, you're in California, right?
Yeah.
So for you, everything is, I mean,
we
don't have many accounts in California because of your taxes.
Yeah. Yeah.
We don't solicit any business out there. We don't have any reps or any brokers or any salesmen or anything, because I understand the dilemma that you have in California with your wholesale taxes. And my cigars are pricey to begin with. And then you add the California tax. It makes my cigars really, they're not cheap dates. Mm-hmm. And so where was I going with this? I had a point, but I've already lost it.
Well, and what really frustrates me in California is I know of a lot of shops that will, because as we have it, you have your normal margin, then you put your tobacco tax on top and there's your end result. Right. A lot of shops will take the wholesale cost tobacco tax and double both or even more. And it's
most shops do margin the tax. I don't know what happens. Again, like I told you, my weakest part of this is the sales side, the part that you're on.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Do most shops margin that 67% tax in California, or do they just take the 67 and pass it on? And I got to tell you, neither of those answers makes sense to me. If I was a retailer, I would have to margin it some, because money isn't free.
And right.
If you as a retailer have to spend 67% more for something,
right. That's
tying up 67% more cash that you can't deploy into something else in your shop.
Right.
So you have to charge something beyond the 67. But I think keystoning, taking the 67 and doubling it, I just think that's a mistake.
Yeah. No, I agree. 100%.
It's just too big a bite. But that's easy for me to say. I don't run a shop in California. I don't pay your insurance. I don't pay your employees. I don't run your business.
Right.
You know what I mean? So for me to sit here in New Hampshire and tell you how to do what you do where you do it is just absurd, because I don't know squat.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and you're familiar with Rob Gagne from Boveda?
Yeah.
And so he once, we talk back and forth a lot, and he's like, what I learned in because also Minnesota's tobacco tax is really high. And when he worked at a brick and mortar there, he's like, sometimes you have to play with those margins between separate companies to make it kind of even out. But here, we got... another question here. Actually, Raider Dave is wondering, and I know this is a common question, can we expect anything new from Dunbarton this year? If so, can you elaborate on any shades or sizes? Yeah, I know it's always the question. What's new? What's new?
A question. And also, it's a question that irritates us all. I mean, let me tell you why that question. It's like you put so much time and effort, and as soon as you finish something and it's just on the shelf for 2 months, in today's society, it's like, well, that's so yesterday.
Right.
I mean? And the problem is, we're in the handmade cigar business. Everything we do takes so long.
Yeah.
And the problem that you have is the consumer's desire for new. Look, I'm guilty of it too, so I'm not in an ivory tower on this, but it actually produces bad cigars.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we actually, and we see it every year. I mean, since 1890, there have been 350,000 brand introductions in the United States market in handmade cigars. 350,000. Wow. How many of those have stuck around?
Right.
I mean, for every brand that a consumer sees on the shelf, there are literally 300 or 400 others that your retailer has not chosen to bring in and probably never even heard of that fail every year. There's easily 300 to 400 that fail every year, even in the current environment. But to get back to the question, I need to figure out a way to catch up.
Okay.
Last year, we probably left about $2 million in sales on the table because we didn't have a steady flow to meet the demand.
Wow.
So that's really my core concern for 2022.
Yeah.
But separate of that, I also understand the importance of feeding the beast. So what you're going to see is you're going to probably see some small releases. You know, not a whole brand line launch, because for all practical purposes, Stillwell Star is really a 2022 brand, because we didn't start shipping those boxes until November of 2021.
Okay.
Paladin de Saka is essentially a new cigar. Very few people have had a chance to smoke that. We just began shipping it right before Christmas. We only shipped it for like 3 days before we shut down for the holiday. Most of that got shipped in the first half of January. But we'll add a size to the Muestra de Saka line.
Okay.
I will end up doing a couple other little ancillary things. We're going to do an introduction on the Mi Querida Black Blend. But that isn't much work for me because I did the work as part of an exclusive for another retailer. So it's really me just making it available to all of our retailers.
I recently saw a picture of that. Yeah.
Yeah. And I have a few other things, but it'll be more of that kind of sprinkling in. I'll change my mind when we get off this. But the current plan is to probably limit it to a few of those things and try to get a little bit more even keel.
Okay.
And the other thing too that most consumers don't realize is we're really not in very many shops. I mean, we're maybe in 400, 450. Okay. Cindy and Dave would know better than me because I don't pay close attention to it. But there's a lot of shops for us to still go into.
Yeah.
And the other thing that's happened to us is most of our shops are doing very well now. Not all of them. Product doesn't work for everyone. But most of them, the turns are up in almost every location.
Awesome.
So we have the growth pressure of not new. And it's one of the reasons why, I mean, for the last 18 months, about the only new accounts we've been opening were the ones that showed up at the trade shows.
Yeah.
And it's really because we kind of take the attitude that if this person took the time to come out of their way to come to the trade show, then we're going to open them. But I mean, I think right now we have about 200 accounts on the waiting list that we have yet to open.
Wow.
That have contacted us, and we have to find a way to, we can't just forever not open new accounts.
Right.
Look, it's as in any business, if you're not growing, you're essentially dying.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just the way business works. And I have to find a way to address that. And the other thing too is, I just don't have anything in the portfolio that really needs to be shot.
Yeah.
Everything, even the original Sobremesa, it's 6 years old now, but the sales on that are still increasing, 35, 40 points.
Right.
Year over year, every single year. And so I don't really have anything that needs to come off the shelf or be replaced. Now, for certain shops, yes. Certain shops don't do well with regular Sobremesa. Other shops don't do well with, Sin Compromiso, but that's becoming less and less as the brand gets better known and the product gets better known and I get more organic word of mouth from consumer to consumers. Mm-hmm. That's not even as true. And even some of our early adopters, we have a policy at Dunbarton where, and I'm sure they explained this to you when you open the account. If they did, I'm going to tell you now. We'll take those cigars back.
Like, yeah,
when you bought them from me, this is not the way it normally works in our business. When you buy
Cigars, right?
And they expect you to put it in Ziploc baggies as samplers or buy one, get one. You know, they'll never take product back. We're totally different. We'll take anything back. We prefer to take stuff back that's in sealed boxes, because if it isn't a sealed box, we have to destroy it and throw it away. But even in that case, we'll still give the retailer their money back. And that seems like a foolish policy to a lot, but and mostly to most of my competitors, but they're just being very short-sighted about it. Because I'm happy you opened an account with us, Eric, but honestly, it doesn't fucking matter.
Yeah.
What matters is, do you order the next time, the time after that, the time after that?
Right.
Do you become a steady customer? Does it turn for you? Does it work for the customers in your store? Do they like it? That's where the business is done. The business is not done in getting into a new store.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. That's not what's relevant. So those early adopters, when the brand was far less known, and we had a lot of very big ones that shouldn't have brought us in and even tried to talk them out of it. They didn't do well, but most of them are now coming back of their own accord.
Yeah.
And part of it's because, yeah, we'll take it back. No problem. Yeah. Send it back. We'll give you full credit. Never called them, never hassled them, never said, well, we got this new thing and it's doing great. And we just left it alone. And eventually what ends up happening is they see how it's doing. They have enough consumers that come to their store and badger them over it. And they're finally like, you know what? I want to give it another chance. And because we parted well, it makes it possible to then have that introduction again.
Right.
So, you know, for example, a shop like Davidus, right? I don't know if you're familiar with Davidus, Mid-Atlantic chain of stores.
Okay. 14
really nice brick and mortar stores, really big customer, did really bad with us, took it all back. No problem. Love you. Boom, boom, boom. Here it is 4 years later. Last year they brought it. Well, no, 4 years, 5 years later, they brought it back in. And Davidus, still not a big account, but they're like $60,000 a year. That wouldn't have been possible had I told them, hey, you fucking bought it. It's yours, pal.
Right. Right.
You know what I mean?
And it's in kind of similar in what you're saying on the retail side. I mean, because we bring in new brands, we drop new brands, especially this last year. It's kind of refining our humidor, what's really doing well, what's not. And I'll echo the same thing. We bring in a new brand, and that's great, but it's got to prove itself on the shelf if it's going to be really like a staple here. It's got to pay its rent, essentially.
Absolutely. Everything has to earn its space on the shelf. And Raider Dave, you didn't poke me. I'm just always like this. I'm just antagonistic by nature.
But that's part of doing business. A huge company that is done well with us, especially with just the kind of like demographic, is, are you familiar with Black Label Trading Company?
Yeah, sure, but I wouldn't classify them as a big company.
No, it just as far as
a good brand works really well in your store.
Yeah, exactly. And bringing them in, you just don't know, and then it's got to see how it does through the year, and it's steadily grown, and it's done great. And so it's kind of that.
But as you well know, Eric, I mean, it has a lot to do with what you as an individual retailer, you have a lot of sway over what your consumers ultimately smoke and don't smoke. They're looking to you for guidance, right? They want you. And look, and you as a retailer, you want to give good faith recommendations because you don't want to burn that equity of trust that you have built with your customers.
Right.
So, and we see it in our case. I mean, we have stores that are just regular little brick and mortar stores that are like 80 and 90K year accounts at this point, because their staff, they've decided that, okay, when someone comes in the store and they say, hey, I want a Connecticut Broadleaf, you know, stronger cigar, that me, Querida, is one of the ones that they always suggest.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Somebody comes in and says, hey, I want something mild in Connecticut shade. Hey, have you tried a Brulee? I think it's one of the absolute best Connecticut shade cigars in the store.
Right.
That's something that I can't – look, I'm always going to say that, right? I make a dime for everything. Where you as a retailer, yes, you're selling that customer something, but you have no vested interest in selling product A over product B. Mm-hmm. You make relatively the same margin regardless. And as you well said, it has to earn its spot. Because you will replace it with something else, because there are hundreds of brands that wish to be in that spot. And if it's not another brand, it's from an existing brand that wishes they just had more space in your store. So, I mean, in the end, I think that the thing that at the retail environment is really having that individual champion in the store has way more impact than I could ever have. No, the cigar can't suck. It has to be good.
right, or right,
that it doesn't ring true. You can recommend something and you can get a guy to try something, but when she comes back and it sucks, she ain't buying it again regardless.
Right. Well, and here's something that I will say I appreciate from the lineup of Dunbarton Tobacco, especially the kind of the lineup that we brought in. So bring up this graphic again. We have both Sobremesas and both Mi Queridas. And Triqui Traca, of course, is a personal favorite of mine. Within this lineup, though, you've got two using Connecticut Broadleaf, right, which right now, as some of us know, it's somewhat of a harder leaf to get your hands off or more hands on or more expensive. Yeah. So to me, it kind of shows really the intentionality, I guess. It's not a, well, we needed a Maduro, so we kicked out this. It was very affordable. And we did, like, you already have, you're climbing uphill, essentially, to produce these.
We also have to understand that I have a very definite target in mind.
Okay.
Look, the cigars that I make, the vast majority of the cigars, I only make one cigar that retails sub $10 MSRP. And that's called Umbagog. And it's a really good cigar for the money. It really is.
Yeah.
It isn't of the caliber of my other cigars, but in its price point, it punches way above its weight class. But the only reason why it exists is because I need some place to put the Connecticut Broadleaf that I don't deem worthy of putting on Mi Querida. Because I want Mi Querida to have the very best of the best.
Yeah.
And if I want to have the very best of the best, I have to have a place to put the sirloin. So where does the sirloin go? Connecticut Broadleaf costs so much, it forces me to make another brand. Mm-hmm. Umbagog serves that purpose. It allows me to cash or cover. But because I have Umbagog to serve as that relief valve for the Mi Querida, it also helps keep the Mi Querida prices where they are currently, which is somewhere between $12 and $14 on average, MSRP, right? Right. And I think like the Grand Buffalo, the big giant ones are like $14.95 or something, but most are in the $12 to $14 range. But if Umbagog didn't exist, giving me that relief valve,
okay,
Mi Querida would be the same price as Liga Privada.
Interesting. There's no way
it couldn't be the price of Liga Privada.
Yeah.
It isn't as though the materials are costing me less, and it isn't though the cigar is of a lower quality construction. I would argue maybe it's better, but I'm going to leave that up to the consumer to determine. But most of what I make is in that $12 to $20 range. I mean,
yeah.
Sin Compromiso is one of my best cigars. It ranges, what, 15 to 18 MSRP. All the Muestra de Sacas are $18.75. I mean, Brulee Blues are like a $16, you know, Connecticut Shade Lonsdale. So mm-hmm. I'm not trying to sell to everybody. I'm going after a very specific consumer.
Okay. You know,
I'm going after someone that is more experienced, someone that's more discerning, somebody that can appreciate the difference. Because if you can't, when you smoke any of these cigars, then you shouldn't buy them. Mm. Because you can buy a perfectly smokable, enjoyable, decent cigar
mm-hmm.
for $4 less. I know that. But you can't smoke the same caliber cigar.
Right, right.
But if you can't tell the difference, then why does it matter?
Yeah, yeah. Why would you gravitate towards $150, $200 bottle of bourbon when you haven't really drank much bourbon?
If you love Southern Comfort, you love Southern Comfort. And there's no sin in loving Southern Comfort.
If
that suits your palate. So, you know, it's part of the thing. So I'm really going after a much smaller audience with my product. I'm not trying to be everything to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing that makes the line very distinct is the fact that it's just me. I'm the final arbitrator of everything. Like when I'm making blends, nobody gets their 2 cents. Nobody even gets to smoke samples. Like the people in my office, they get it when it's in the fucking box, no different than the retailer. They don't get to say, oh, I wish it was this. I wish it was that. I think it should be this. Oh, I want that. No. They can go start their own goddamn cigar company if they want to do that, right?
Right. It's not,
I don't take cues from other people. And the reason why is because, A, I know what I like, and I'm confident about what I like, and I also accept the fact that I know it's not going to appeal to everybody. But at the same time, when you start getting into that kind of minutia, it dumbs everything down. It makes everything homogenized. It makes everything a little bland, a little boring, because you can make any blend, hand it out to 10 people, and you will get 10 different opinions in the same 10 people. One guy will tell you it's not strong enough. Another guy will tell you it's too strong.
Yeah.
What do you do with this information?
Right.
And that's
right.
One of the reasons why so many of the large companies' products is not that they don't make good cigars.
Mm-hmm.
But what the problem is, they focus group everything to death.
Yeah.
So what ultimately ends up happening is they make cigars that are good, decent, smokable, but they don't make cigars that enthrall you or mm-hmm. give you passion or something that is actually unique, or you know what I mean?
Yeah,
you
no, definitely.
On that. You know, and but again, I don't have their pressures either. You know, they have 2,000 employees. They got to pay for all those families and all of that. I don't have to worry about, I don't have to sell $100 million a year to be successful.
Right. Right. So
it makes it a little easier for me. It's easy to be on a high mountain perch when you don't have to worry about it.
Yeah. No, yeah, you know no, that totally makes sense. Uh-huh. Well, and kind of with your blending and such, we got a question from Omar kind of in the same vein. And I know this is another question that probably is not a manufacturer's favorite, because asking like, which is your favorite child, but what's your favorite I want to ask, what's your favorite Dunbarton tobacco cigar? And then
it's like asking you which of your children. Depends on my mood.
Okay.
I mean, look, in certain lines, I have certain ones I tend to smoke more. I mean, in Brulee, I tend to smoke more Toros and Blues. In regular Mi Querida Blue, I tend to smoke mostly Ancho Largos and Gorditas.
Okay.
In the Sobremesa, I smoke Cervantes Finos and the Elegante and Cedros. In Triqui Traca, I'm almost exclusively the 648 in Triqui Traca. I really have a lot of love for that size.
Yeah.
In the Muestra, I'm Naka Tamale all the way. I'd rather smoke a Naka Tamale than a Unicorn. I'd rather smoke the $18 Naka Tamale than the $100 Unicorn. I have my favorites. As far as non-DT cigars, I have ones that I enjoy. But I don't enjoy any of them as much as I enjoy mine. And part of the reason why is, no, I don't mean it in that kind of way. I want you to think about it from this term. If I'm doing all the cooking, and I'm cooking exclusively for my palate,
mm-hmm.
then it only makes sense that I would prefer to smoke my own cigars.
Yeah.
I'm the guy making the red sauce. I decide, do I like the veggies in it? Do I like the meat in it? Do I like it a little sweeter? Do I like it a little more savory? Do I like it to be a bit spicy? So for me, the cigars that I make are just heads and shoulders above. But it's because they're being custom blended to suit me.
Right, right.
Now, are there other products that I like? Yeah, I like some of the stuff that comes out of Tatuaje. I've always liked some of the stuff that Pete makes. I like some of the stuff out of La Flor Dominicana. You know, typically it's something, you know, some of the heavier stuff, the Chisels and the DL600 kind of cigars, you know, and the Double Ajero.
Mm-hmm.
I guess the DL stands for Double Ajero, so that's kind of redundant. I still to this day, I still think Fuente makes some of the best Cameroon cigars that have ever been made.
Okay.
I always have Don Carlos kicking around the humidor. I don't smoke many of them, but I keep Padron 1926s, okay. number ones, and then the little one, the number 44. You know, so there's certain cigars that are in my humidor, but with me smoking even the number of cigars I smoke a day, it makes it very hard for me to enjoy other ones.
Okay.
Part of what I do though is typically my second cigar of the day is normally somebody else's cigar because I'm always curious.
Yeah.
And I always get my second cigar of the day because I don't want to be disappointed with my first cigar. So, because what'll end up happening is the second cigar, if I light it and I don't like it, I'll just instantly pitch it.
Okay.
And if I like it or I think there's something interesting or I want to see where it goes, I'll smoke it through. But honestly, I don't know, one out of every five I might smoke through. Most of them I smoke a half an inch. I'm like, okay, I got this. This isn't for me. But, you know, I'm always being given samples. And so I try to make a point of trying to smoke something I haven't smoked most every day.
Okay.
And every once in a while, I'll pull something out that's part of the mix, you know, that I don't smoke a lot of Davidoff, and I don't smoke lucky for me, I've never been a big Opus guy. Mm. I'd much rather smoke an Añejo. So I saved a lot of money not being an Opi guy. so that helps. And, when it comes to, you know, I'm not a 1,000 series Padron smoker. They're just a little too spongy and a little too airy for me. And if I'm going to smoke a Padron, I'd rather smoke one of the more like the anniversary or a higher grade than that.
Yeah. Yeah.
It just kind of mixes up.
So, and I know we're kind of coming to the close here, but I wanted to ask you a question. And my first introduction to Dunbarton, it was, I don't know, 4 years ago. I went into a brick and mortar shop. This is way before I had my own shop. And I saw the Sobremesa, not the Brulee, but the normal, which was your first line.
It was the first one we released. Yes.
Okay. So the owner of this shop told me, what do you like to smoke? And I said, I like more heavier stuff, fuller body stuff. So he picks up the Sobremesa, says, this is going to be very strong.
It's I don't think really it's strong at all. I think it's medium body.
Exactly. And so that was my experience. And I was like, this is not what I was looking for in this cigar.
Yeah,
so
yeah, and that goes back to just like, I don't get to control how the cigars are cared for after they
right.
I don't get to control how people speak about them, but
exactly.
Sobremesa, in my opinion, is on a 10-point scale. It's a 5.
Yeah.
5, yeah. 5.5. With the exception, the short Churchill is stronger. And the Elegante and Cedros that you have is slightly stronger because those were both blended a year later.
Okay.
So after I had been smoking the regular Sobremesa for a year, kind of like, I think I can tick up the strength a little bit. And,
okay.
And those two sizes, the strength is ticked up a bit. But still, if the others are a 5, they're a 6. Sobremesa in itself, I don't think is, I would consider definitely middle of the road, medium. It's an elegant cigar. It's a balanced yes. cigar. It's a nuanced yeah. cigar. Has a lot of interesting flavor components going on. Yeah, I mean, if you got a really super sensitive palate, you can detect a little bit of like almost anise, some licorice kind of notes going on in it. It's a really exceptional cigar, but by no stretch is it a strong cigar.
Right.
Which kind of in some ways might hurt it a little bit because
yeah,
it looks like a strong cigar because the wrapper color is so dark.
Right.
Right. And that can be scary to some consumers. Another thing that I think for the unexperienced consumer with my cigars is I think the feel of them will scare them a little because my cigars are very densely packed. The bunching yeah. techniques that I employ. So an average Toro with Ecuador Habano wrapper is going to weigh somewhere around 15.2 to 15.4 grams for a 6x52.
Okay.
Maybe 15.8 out of some factories. Mine typically weighs somewhere between 17.9 and 18.5.
Whoa.
So mine actually typically have somewhere around 12 to 14% more actual tobacco in the same size.
Okay. Yeah.
So to the consumer, the cigar feels rock hard, right? And they're so used to when they get a cigar and it feels rock hard that they're going to have a poor smoking experience, that the draw is going to be tight. But I think anyone that's smoked a lot of my cigars will say that tightness is rarely an issue with my cigars. And it's yeah. because of the techniques that we employ during the bunching. They're more complex. They're more intricate. They require more time. But again, that's reflected in the price.
Right, right.
The benefit, though, of that is it slows the burn down. It makes the cigar burn much cooler. It lets you taste more of the flavors. It gets rid of that kind of biting sensation that you can sometimes get out of a cigar. And the other advantage is my cigars will typically smoke 15 to 20 minutes longer. If you typically yeah. smoke a Toro in an hour, mine will probably take you about an hour and 20 minutes to smoke.
Okay.
The only exception to that is in the Sin Compromiso line. The Sin Compromiso line is a soft prensado, a soft press. Mm-hmm. So those aren't as densely packed as the rest. I think
right.
they burn more like a traditional cigar would of a comparable
okay.
size,
okay.
except the Paladin. The Paladin is a much more densely packed style of cigar. And the Paladin's a long burn. It takes a while. Now, does the consumer mathematically? Because the reality is it seems like my cigar is more expensive. But if you actually figure out how much time you smoke it, the math actually works out in their favor.
Yeah.
But I don't know that they think that way.
Yeah.
And ultimately, that's not the consumer who I'm targeting anyways.
Right.
Because I don't think that guy is going to be a Dunbarton smoker. If you're concerned about getting if you're concerned about getting a deal, there are way better brands to buy.
Gotcha. Yeah.
They just are.
Yeah, it's coming back to that target audience. And there's just a few more questions I want to pull, but kind of with that, I will say smoking the Sobremesa at the show was the first time I actually picked up that cigar again since that experience. And knowing that knowledge going into it, I was like, this cigar is a whole new experience to me. Well, yeah, it's very nuanced. It's very balanced. It was,
look, if somebody tells you something's going to be super mild and super creamy and super sweet, and it tastes like the ass end of a chimpanzee when you smoke it, bad idea. But if I said to you, hey, this is a real barnyard, real funky style, you know, heavy cigar. It's got a little bit of rustic to it. It's a little bit dirty, but it's got that really interesting kind of umami thing going. You would have a different opinion about the chimpanzee ass cigar because you were told what it was. And that's always a very big thing. I think if you go to our website, I think we do a really good job.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Detailing out what each of the cigars are. And what the flavor notes are and what the experiences are. And yeah, listen, I wrote it to be flowery, but there's truth in it. It's not just the sales pitch, because it's really important to me that the consumer understand.
Like, yeah,
the Muestra line is one of the most confusing because every blend in the Muestra is entirely different. The Exclusivo has no connectivity to a Nacatamale, to a Now Leave Me the Hell Alone. An Exclusivo is a mild to medium cigar made with all vintage tobaccos. The youngest tobacco has been bale-aged 5 years. At this point, most of them are over 7 years, 7 to 10 years. It's a very smooth, very mild, kind of nuanced, sophisticated, elegant style cigar. Whereas the Nacatamale, much stronger cigar, probably a 7.5, 8 on a 10 scale, roughly.
Okay.
More direct, much more simplistic, you know, yeah. I think explaining to the consumer and to the retailer what these things actually are sets the table appropriately.
It does.
Right. I mean,
yes,
if I'm being told it's Italian food, but when I sit down, it tastes like Mexican food, we got a problem.
Right. Right.
And it's not that I don't love Mexican food.
Right.
I just don't want to be told that this is a classic Italian and then I'm tasting taco.
Yes. No, exactly. So before I pull our last questions for those watching, if you haven't had a chance to check out our sampler, this is what we're lining up tonight, including the new Triqui Traca 4x48. This sampler is available in the description of this video. If you click on that link, it'll direct you to our website. That's where you can pick it up. Killer lineup.
Strength-wise, they pretty much go left to right.
Yeah. Yeah. We kind of organize it that way.
And the nice thing about that sampler is I think it gives you a really good spectrum of the style of cigars that we make. And I can say, if you're a consumer and you smoke all five of those and you don't like any of them, you shouldn't buy anything else I make because you probably won't like them. Yeah. No, just, I'm being honest. There should be something in that mix that will appeal to most people.
Definitely, definitely. And so Cigar has one of the last questions saying, as far as the Muestra line, with the Krakatoa pepper bomb on the back burner, what direction did you take?
The Bewitched has a little bit of that Todos Los Dias property because it's super smooth, but it's also strong.
Okay.
I think on a 10-point scale, I think it kind of starts off as like a 5-ish, a 6-ish, but towards the tail end, it kind of creeps up to like an 8. I'm actually gonna have to sit and think about how to describe this blend.
Okay.
Because the reason why I named it the Bewitched, there's multiple reasons why, but I don't know why. There's just something about the blend that I find really entrancing. Okay. It doesn't have anything that is really distinct about it.
Okay.
So like, look, me, Querida, it's an earthy cigar. It's got the Connecticut broadleaf sweetness. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
it's got those typical coffee notes that you would expect, those chocolate notes. Triqui Traca is just the opposite side of the coin. Same basic flavor profile, but amped up strength-wise. It's a bit more pepper forward. You get a bit more bite. You get a bit more of a spiciness. You still have the earthiness. You still have the sweetness from the broadleaf. You still have the coffee notes, but the coffee notes are now a little more bitter. They're more like espresso. Same thing with the chocolate. The chocolate's more like a dark chocolate than a regular chocolate.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But
yep.
I haven't quite figured out how I'm going to describe the Bewitched yet. And in fact, I smoked like four of them today, actually, trying to think about how am I going to describe this cigar in a way that gives an accurate reflection to the consumer before they buy it. But it's definitely – The reason I named it Bewitched is because it's just, I find it, I don't know, there's just something entrancing about it.
Okay.
There's not any one thing I can point to in it that makes it so. So the answer is, I got the cigar, it's done, I like it. I haven't quite figured out how to explain it yet.
Okay. Yeah, well, and kind of in explanation of blends and such, the last question is, Chip had mentioned he picked up a Paladin de Saka, mm-hmm. and he's wondering, he's going to smoke it tomorrow. What is there something, what would he expect from that cigar?
What he should expect is he should expect Sin Compromiso, but ticked up a bit strength-wise.
Okay.
I mean, it's still at its core a Sin Comp, and a Sin Comp is a medium-bodied blend that's super heavy flavor, but it's also really smooth and really creamy. I think that the Sins pretty much are probably like a 6 out of 10 strength-wise for the most part.
Okay.
The Paladin is the same, but much like the Mi Querida blue, red versus the blue, the Paladin variation is, again, a slightly amped up, slightly spicier version. But at the same time, I toned it down a little bit because I slowed the burn down on the cigar by giving it a full prensado, which helps to slow the combustion temperature down.
Okay.
I didn't want that increase in strength to result in that back peppery bite. See, for me, mm-hmm. a cigar has to be smooth.
So okay.
I don't tend to make cigars that'll blow your head off. I occasionally will smoke them. I'll smoke, like I mentioned, the DLs and the Chisels and Aromacraft Neanderthal or something like that. But
mm-hmm.
I don't like to smoke those on the regular. I like cigars that are okay. strong enough to be satisfying as I'm smoking them. But I like them also, even when they're strong, to still be smooth. I don't like it to irritate my throat. I don't like to retrohale and feel like I'm, you know, shoving firecrackers up my nose.
Yeah.
That's me. That's what I like. Look, there's consumers that absolutely love, you know, that totally unbridled, super rough, super harsh, super strong. My experience, though, is that's a phase that most cigar smokers go through.
Mm.
They start, they dial up, they get to a point where they hit this crazy strength plateau, and then almost always they drift a little bit back because they start to realize that, oh, I'm giving up so much in flavor and so much in aroma and so much in just enjoyment to get that. So most consumers, not all, there's always going to be guys that want their heads blown off. That's always going to exist. But most consumers, they want smooth cigars, even when they're strong. And so for me, that's always a kind of a cornerstone of what I do. And it really stems from, I'm sure people have heard me tell this story before, but so when I was 25, I went to Honduras for a month and I shadowed Estelo Padron. Estelo Padron was the brother of Jose Orlando Padron of the famous Padrons.
Okay.
They used to be partners in the Padron cigars, and then they had a family falling out, and that brother left, and he became the master cigar maker at Hatsa in Honduras, in Cofradía, Honduras. And at the time, he happened to make some of my favorite cigars. So I spent a month down there working for free. Just kind of like on an internship because I was curious.
And
at one point he said to me, Saka, remember, the most important thing I want you to know about cigars is this, right? And he pounds his chest like this. And of course, I'm 24, 25. I'm like, heart, passion. He's like, fuck that. No, what I want is when the guy is smoking this cigar and he gets towards the end that he's checking his pocket to see if he has another cigar. That's how you know a cigar is a good cigar. That you don't want it to end.
Yeah,
you don't want the experience to stop, that you're enjoying it so much. So that's always something. It's something that pretty much runs through most of my cigars is I want them to be strong and satisfying when you're smoking them, but I also want them to leave you craving a little, you know? Mm-hmm. I want them.
Well, and my first experience with Triqui Traca, I got a 5-pack of the 5x52. Absolutely love the interpretation of that blend. I love the strength behind it, the flavor. And that was my biggest disappointment about it. I was like, I just want it to last longer because of how
much
I
enjoy it. Which is perfect for a guy that makes cigars for a living to sell because you got to buy more.
See, yeah.
That's the magic of it all.
Right.
But that's the way it is. You get the point. This is like, oh, man, this bottle's almost empty. I got to buy another bottle.
Right.
I'm down to the bottom of this bag of potato chips. This sucks. Oh, that last slice of pizza sitting in the box. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And look, when things are good, they make you feel that way. They make you feel like, hey, I wish there was more. And so I always have Estelo pounding his chest in my head, thinking about that. And it's something that I've you know, I've always taken to heart. And when you're a guy like me that's smoking 10 cigars a day, I'm basically doing runner, 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 right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I don't tend to like cigars that just completely destroy me.
Okay. Yeah.
Totally. I want to be able to continue, mm-hmm. you know, and mm-hmm. so we'll see, but I don't know. The one thing that's universally true of cigars is that in the end, there's only one judge, and that's the individual smoker. Right. They have to decide for themselves whether, no matter how much I pontificate, it doesn't matter. Mm. Because ultimately, they're going to judge it for themselves, and they're going to make a determination of whether it's worthwhile or it's not worthwhile.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Well, I want to thank you, Steve, for jumping on the channel with us. It's been an absolute education, and we're really excited to have Dunbarton here. We were one of those accounts that coming up to TP, we're like, okay, this is definitely where we need to stop. And definitely bring them in because we've been wanting to have it inside the shop. So we're really happy to have it here.
I hope it fares well for you. But if not, send the shit back.
Definitely. Well, thank you so much. Yeah, we're excited for those who coming up to the shop tomorrow. The official brand release happens tomorrow at 6:00. It's going to be great. We're going to do a pairing with Redbreast. And also pick up the sampler pack. Try all the lines.
Well, thank you very much, Eric. I appreciate the support, and I hope your customers enjoy the cigars.
Awesome. You have a great night.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.